Good afternoon, everyone. So we are going to start. Ronnie Senamiya, and my name is SHO, internal medicine, year 2. And this is an oncology grandson, like Professor Vyachika has said. So I'm presenting MJ, a 13-year-old male from Kasese. Next of kin was a father and was admitted at UCI, that is PED Oncology, on 2nd of September 2019 and discharged on the 20th of the same month. And came in as a referral from Chirudu Hospital for further evaluation and management of a possible hematological malignancy. His presenting complaints were progressive abdominal distension, these symptoms, and then hearing impairment for the past 2 months. And they reported that the patient was relatively well until 2 months prior to admission, gradually developed a painless progressive abdominal distension, which was more marked in the left upper quadrant and the right upper quadrant, and was associated with these symptoms: abdominal discomfort, loss of appetite, early satiety with occasional vomiting of blood and urinary stools. Then still during the same period of time, he later developed a progressive loss of hearing in both ears and then also some dizziness. However, there were no any other CNS symptoms. Following all that, went to Chilembe Hospital, was managed for H. pylori-induced gastritis because of his occasional upper GI bleeding, but never got any improvement. Then was referred to Chirudu, where woke up when it was done, it revealed a possible hematological malignancy. And thereafter, Chirudu referred the patient to UCI for better management. Review of systems were unremarkable. In his past medical and surgical history, was HIV seronegative. This was his second admission, and the first was at Chirudu. I never had any chronic illnesses. Never had any prior history of blood transfusions or using any medications or exposure to radiotherapy. And never had any history of major surgical operations. Family social history was the second born. Out of 3 children, siblings were well. Was in primary 6 and was out due to his current illness. Both parents were well and peasant farmers, and there was no family history of a hematological malignancy. In summary, I've presented a 13-year-old male referred from Chirudu Hospital with a 2-month history of progressive right upper quadrant and left upper quadrant painless abdominal distension associated with these symptoms: early satiety, occasional hematemesis, and urinary stools, plus a 2-month history of progressive hearing impairment without any other CNS symptoms. So the provisional diagnosis at that point of time was a hematological malignancy. First on the list was a myeloproliferative disorder, probably CML, that is chronic myeloid leukemia, essential thrombocytosis or primary myelofibrosis, complicated by upper GI bleeding to query the cause with a leukostasis, with a eighth cranial palsy, and then also lymphoma. Now for hematological malignancy, it was in view of the history of progressive abdominal distension, which was more marked in the right and left upper quadrant. So we thought probably that could be a hepatosplenomegaly. And often we have CML, essential thrombocytosis, and then primary myelofibrosis. They can present with what? Hepatosplenomegaly. And then upper GI bleeding, it could be due to a basophilia. At times these tumors produce basophils which release histamine, and then you get ulcerations, secondary to those high levels of what? Histamines. And then you get GI ulcerations. Then it could be also due to portal hypertension, because if the tumor is infiltrating into the spleen, you can end up with portal hypertension, and then later you get what? Gastric varices, which can easily what? Bleed. Leukostasis, if you have a hematological malignancy and then you have these very many white cell counts in the circulation, they can at times stick onto vessels, you end up with viscosity, and then you can easily get what? CNS symptoms mainly, and then the pulmonary what? Manifestations. So CNS, they can present with focal neurological deficits. So here we are querying eighth cranial nerve palsy, probably the cochlear what? Part of the Of the cranial nerve. And then lymphoma, they can still present with the hepatosplenomegaly B symptoms. That is why they were top on our what list. And then other differentials which you could think about, maybe cirrhosis complicated by hepatocellular carcinoma and upper GI bleeding. However, we never had very probably any history of maybe chronic liver disease. It wasn't really given in the history, so it really came down. Maybe a GI malignancy, it could be CS stomach, but still unlikely because of the age. Then you could think maybe of maybe CA pancreas, but also very unlikely, eh? Given the presentation of the patient, often we have obstructive jaundice plus other what? Signs and symptoms. Rarely do we get B symptoms. Then hyperactive myelinating splenomegaly syndrome is living in the tropics, eh? So it could be a differential. Then schistosomiasis, it came also down. We never had any history of maybe contact with a freshwater body. So still, we just thought about it and to put it down. Then viscerolasmaniasis can also give us hepatosplenomegaly. And then amyloidosis, it could, amyloidosis has different types. It could be following maybe renal dialysis. It could be following maybe chronic infections plus maybe genetic forms. And then Gaucher's disease, eh? Which is a glycogen storage disorder, whereby there is accumulation of some glycoproteins within the WBCs and the RBCs due to some deficiency of one of the enzymes which metabolizes that glycoprotein. So those were our differentials. Going ahead on physical examination, a general exam was sick looking, wasted, was febrile, and the temperature was 39.1 degrees Celsius, had a severe pallor, and the ECOG score. ECOG score is the Eastern Cooperative of Oncology Group. It's a performance score which oncologists use. There are other scores which can also be used. But ECOG score here, the patient we say is, was symptomatic. So that score runs from 0 up to 5. Zero is symptomatic, but the patient is not having any maybe impairment in the daily activities of living. Then five is death. So there he was, the patient we could say was symptomatic, but almost 50% of the times was in what? Bed, eh? But could walk out of bed, shower, so on. Then vitals was tachypnea 24, temperature 39, the BPs were normal, and then had the tachycardia of 130, and the pain score was 1. A CNS exam significantly, we had a 8th cranial nerve palsy. That one we basically examined it simply. We never went into the details of Rennie's test, Weber's test. We just went to a distance of around 30 centimeters and then we aired out some words. And the patient couldn't really pick. And then there was no other focal neurological deficits. Fundoscopy wasn't done, but it could be important here to look at any retinal hemorrhages, papillary edema, which can also occur in these hematological malignancies. So ENT, there was no remarkable findings. A respiratory, significant, it was only the tachypnea which we got there. Then a CVS, a had warm extremities with the tachycardia. And other things were unremarkable. But abdomen was asymmetrically distended with more in the upper quadrants. With the hepatosplenomegaly, all of them were more than approximately 20 centimeters below the costal margin. And the abdomen was mildly tender, but no ascites or any other significant findings. Skin, no significant findings. So the provisional diagnosis still was hematological malignancy, and still we are having CML, essential thrombocytosis, primary myelofibrosis, and or maybe a lymphoma complicated by severe anemia, sepsis, maybe leukostasis, plus the other differentials on our list. So investigations, these were done. So CBC, peripheral blood film report, they could help us in looking at the morphology of the cells. Then the liver functions, renals, we could look at maybe things like tumor lysis syndrome, which could come as complication. Then urinalysis could help us rule out any other differentials, then also tumor lysis, or at times even amyloidosis. Then bone marrow cytology and flow cytometry, ultrasound scan, they could help us to look for if there are any nodes for any other pathologies. And then blood PCR, for BCR, what? EBO. which is the chromosome 22 Philadelphia what? Chromosome, and then blood cultures plus the viral serologies. So from the findings, significantly had a WBC of 382,000 times 10 to the power 3, with absolute neutrophil count of 343. HB was 59.9. A blood film report showed features of a CML. We are going to show you the slides, and Dr. Namaganda will discuss more about that. And bone marrow was still features of CML with blasts of 5%. And then the blood PCR for BCR ABO was detected at 40% international standard. So these were findings on the flow cytometry. They will be talked about more by Dr. Namaganda. And still features were consistent with CML. Then a liver function test, there were no really significant findings. Albumin, that was slightly low, and then the GDT was also slightly low. Then for renal functions, it was only an isolated hyperkalemia of 5.6. LDH was high, so we had some components of tumor lysis. So blood cultures, we didn't receive results back. Ultrasound scan was hepatosplenomegaly, features of portal hypertension, and then abdominal lymphadenopathy. So our diagnosis was Philadelphia chromosome positive CML in chronic phase, reason being the blasts were less than what, 5%, complicated by severe anemia, secondary to portal hypertension with what, upper GI bleeding, then leukostasis with cranial palsy, then a tumor lysis syndrome because of the elevated LDH and then the hyperkalemia, more of laboratory, not clinical, and then sepsis, though we never got the blood cultures. So the management plan for that patient, we was started on hydroxyurea as an emergency because leukostasis is an emergency. Then was blood transfused with 3 units of packed cells after grouping and cross-matching, given antibiotics, allopurinol for the tumor lysis and also prevention when, so for prevention of the tumor lysis syndrome. Then imatinib is a tyrosine kinase inhibitor because when there is that Philadelphia chromosome, there is activation of the, there is formation of an oncoprotein, which activates the tyrosine kinases. And then they give you the what? Lymphoproliferation of the myeloid line. And then increased fluid intake also to counteract on the possible tumor lysis. Then educating the patients and family about their disease. And then we had to monitor the fluid balance, vitals, the hearing progress, and then pain. Then the reduction of the WBCs. As the tumor lysis probably, sorry, the leukocystasis is improving, and then blood cytogenetics have to be followed up 3 months, 6, and then 12 months to check for any progress. So that is the end of that. So these are the slides. So that was the first case, and then the second case, it's actually almost the same. So this was an 18-year-old female student from Soroti. Next of kin was a sister, admitted on 23rd of September, and then is currently at the UCI, what? Uganda Cancer Institute Hostel, and came in as a referral from Soroti doctor's brother for further evaluation and management of possible hematological malignancy. The presenting complaints were progressive painful abdominal distension for 1 year, and then B symptoms. All this began 1 year ago, and the distension was progressive, located more in the right upper quadrant and the left. And the pain initially was mild, later increased in severity over time, dull in nature, non-radiating, with no aggravating or relieving factors. And reported associated B symptoms, anorexia, early satiety, and constipation, with no any other GI symptoms. At Soroti Hospital was admitted more than 10 times. And was being managed for hyperactive malaria splenomegaly with contemplation of maybe splenectomy. And but later, when he visited, when the patient visited the doctor's plaza at Soroti, from the few investigations they did, they suspected a hematological malignancy, and then referred the patient to what? To Uganda Cancer Institute. Review of systems was unremarkable. A past medical. Like we say, HIV seronegative, the mouth permissions, no chronic illnesses, was not on any chronic medications or prior exposure to radiotherapy, and never had any sort of blood transfusion or surgical operations. was an orphan. Both parents died of unknown illnesses and was the firstborn out of two children. A sibling was well and was staying with a maternal aunt. Was in S2 and was out of school because of the illness. And then reported instead of staying in a war-torn area, that was in the north, more than 10 years ago. Past gain was really unremarkable. So the main concerns of the patient were the chronic disease, whether it will be treated and then improves and then gets back to what? To school. In summary, this was an 18-year-old female referred from Soroti, Doctor's Plaza, with a 1-year history of a progressive right upper quadrant and left upper quadrant painful abdominal distension with associated B symptoms, anorexia, alisatat, and constipation, without any other GI symptoms. So the provisional diagnosis was hematological malignancy, maybe a lymphoma, which can give you hepatosplenomegaly B symptoms, and then myeloproliferative neoplasms, which where we have CML like we discussed in the what? In the previous case. CNL is a chronic neutrophil leukemia. So the differentials actually were similar to the first case. Physical exam was a sick-looking young lady, was wasted a febrile, had mild pallor, lymphadenopathy, which was generalized, and her echo score was 2. So was symptomatic less than 50% of the times what? In bed. Vitals, we significantly had a pain score of 3 out of what? 5. We just used fingers and then the patient is able to score what? His or her pain. And respiratory system, there were no more findings, basically. Still, even CVS, also we had no more findings. But abdomen, it's where we had significant findings. Asymmetrical distended abdomen, more in the upper quadrant, with a hepatosplenomegaly approximately 15 centimeters below the costal margin. And these organs were smooth, more retained, but there was no ascites abdomen. Other systems were really unremarkable. So, still the provisional diagnosis remained, like I've discussed, I've said in the previous case. And these were the investigations which we had done. Still, they are similar to our what? Initial case. So, these were her CBC findings, WBCs of 233 times 10 to the power 3, with an absolute neutrophil count of 294. And then a moderate anemia of 8.1. MCV, MCH were low. And then platelets were slightly elevated at 576. So film report showed a microcytic hypochromic anemia and then evidence of myeloproliferative neoplasm. Most likely what? A CML. There were no hemoparasites which we are seeing. And then marrow aspirate still showed morphological evidence of what? CML. Then other diagnostic tests. Marrow flow cytometry, this is still pending at CPHL. Then BCR EBO, that is the breakpoint cluster region. The EBO chromosomal mutation, they are still running the test actually as I'm talking now, because I had to go to the lab and the lab technician is still running the test right now. So the other tests were really, except for the elevated LDH, but we had no significant findings in the other tests. LFTs, urinalysis, renal functions, and the viral serologies. Abdominal ultrasound scan, similar to the first case. And then had a chest X-ray done, which showed mediastino widening, pale adenopathy, and then reticular infiltrates in the lower lung zones, which we thought it was due to the tumor, giving us a hyal adenopathy, also mediastino adenopathy, reticular infiltrates, maybe due to the stasis within the vasculature of the lungs. So our final diagnosis is CML in chronic phase, complicated by microcytic hypochromic anemia and then protein energy malnutrition in view of the film reported, and then also the what? The HB was 8.7, and then the film report showed a microcytic hypochromic picture and the patient was wasted. So currently, this patient is still on cytoreduction with hydroxyurea, 1 gram BD, for 2 weeks. And has not yet started what? Her definitive treatment, because we want to first get the results of the Philadelphia chromosome so that they normally guide you on which drugs you're going to be giving, the tyrosine kinase inhibitors. So that is, I think, the end of that presentation.